What's poppin', T Squad? It's me, Keisha. I'm here with tonight's All Tea All Shade Married to Medicine review. Okay, so in tonight's episode, we see Quad going to her book signing at Barnes and Nobles. It gave me nostalgia. I have not done a book signing at Barnes and Nobles in years, but I can remember my first signing like it was yesterday. But anywho, so congratulations to her on her cookbook. I actually would like to purchase her cookbook. I might not like Quad's personality on this show, but I would like to support her book because I'm a foodie and I would like to try the recipes that she has in her book, so I might purchase it. Contessa, Heavenly, and Buffy come to the event to support her, and they mad when they gotta stand in line. And this is... Quad shows you telltale signs of how she is as a friend. When she saw them standing there that whole damn time, and she didn't even fucking acknowledge them. As your friends, when you having a book signing, you're controlling the narrative of pretty much what's going on. If you see your friends, you can be like, hey, y'all, come on up here or whatever to your girlfriends. So the fact that she made them stand there, didn't even acknowledge them until they just fucking had to at some point just walk up, says a lot about Quad when it comes to friendship. I don't think I could ever be friends with her. She seems like she's very self-centered. She seems like the friendship is all always would be about her wants, her needs, what she has going on in her life. Support her. Be my listening ear. But she doesn't seem like she's a good friend in return. She tells them that, you know, they talk about her all-white birthday party / book release party. I had one of those when I was 31. I had a book release / birthday party at a nightclub. It was fetch. It was everything. Jackie and Curtis talk to the ladies about the renovations to their home. They're getting their bedroom done, their bathroom done, their kitchen done, their garage expanded. And I believe it's one more. Oh, and then a closet. A big-ass walk-in closet or whatever. And the total cost would be around $260,000 to almost $300,000. And Curtis thinks that's too much money and wants to cut back on a few things. But Jackie feels, because she didn't get to have children, and that was one of the main things that she always wanted, that at this stage of her life, she gets to get the things in her life that she feels will make her happy and fulfilled. And Curtis at that point then, you know, says, you know what? Have at it. Do what you want to do. I don't think $260,000 to $300,000 is a lot for renovations of that magnitude, especially when they have specific things that they want. I think that it's a good price and it's going to add the value to that home if they ever do decide to sell it. So I don't think that's a really bad idea. And once again, we all know Jackie is fitting the bill for this. So Curtis, shut the hell up. Like, just shut the hell up at this point. Contessa and Scott go out with the kids. Things are still very much strained between them. Her daddy comes to Atlanta to visit, and she tells her dad, she was like, you know, I'm not in my program anymore. He was like, no, I didn't know about this. And Scott looking at her like, why the fuck are you bringing this shit up in front of the kids, in front of your father? This supposed to be a good family day outing, and you're bringing up this bullshit. And the daddy was like, you know, I didn't know that you weren't in the program anymore. And she was like, she said something, and Scott tries to butt in to, like, basically say, like, cut this shit out. She's like, no, I'm talking to my daddy right now. And the look on Scott's face, and even the oldest daughter was looking like, oh, shit, did she really just shut down daddy like that? I mean, she shut daddy the fuck down real quick. And so she asked her father how he would feel about coming to Atlanta to watch the children while she go back to school. And both the father and Scott both say no, because, you know, the daddy got his own business. He got his own life. He don't, you know, really want to do all that. And Scott looking like, no, we raised these kids. These are our kids. We've already had the discussion. You're not fucking going back to school. She could very well go to school in Atlanta, but it would cost more. But, I mean, just fucking go to school in Atlanta. Just fucking go to school in Atlanta at this point. Like, if you want it that bad, just pay the extra money and go to school in Atlanta, Contessa. Like, but her and Scott really need to sit down and figure out where they're going to go as far as parenting-wise moving forward. Because Contessa... And I think it's more Contessa than it is Scott, because Contessa is the one that bounces around every fucking 5 minutes with these grandiose ideas that she wants for herself, and she's not taking into consideration that, bitch, you got kids at home. Like, if you didn't want to be a mother like that, you should have had 3 motherfucking kids, bitch. Like, I don't know what to tell you. So Simone and Cecil talk to their oldest son, Miles, about him transferring back to Howard. He didn't do well his first year or even semester there. He wasn't doing what he needed to do, so he moved back home and started going to school at Georgia University or whatever. And since he's been back home, Simone says how she has to wake him up every morning. They have to make sure he does his homework and stuff like that. And I'm like, and I was like, y'all baby the fuck out this grown ass man. And she even admitted it, and Cecil admitted it in their confessional that they have babied him his whole fucking life. And I was like, that's apparent, because I have a college student. I don't wake Kyrese the fuck up. I don't police him about homework and shit like that. He know if he don't do what the fuck he got to do, nigga, you getting the fuck out. My time period as a mother being liable to take care of you, being legally, you know, obligated to take care of you, those days is over. So if you're not going to do what you need to do as a grown motherfucking man, if you're not going to police yourself, if you're not going to be, you know, your own motherfucking boss, your own motherfucking, you know, person that drives you, then that's not my responsibility no more. It's time to show and prove. It's time to show the fuck out. So if he doesn't do what he needs to do, you shipping the fuck up out of here, bruh, at the end of the damn day. And they need to start putting their foot down when it comes to Miles, because Miles very much acts like a kid. Like, come the fuck on. Like, ain't no way in hell could Simone need to be still waking this nigga up for school. What the fuck? I haven't woke Kyrese up to go to school since he was probably like in a fifth grade. Like, girl, if you don't get the fuck out of here with this stupid shit. And I'm not just Simone, Cecil too. Like, is you a man and you letting him act like this? But then again, you don't, Cecil sitting up there with no job, sitting up there twiddling his thumbs, trying to figure out what the fuck he want to do with the second half of his life. So that doesn't say much. So he say, Miles say that, he wants to go to school in California. Boy, California, my motherfucking ass. Nigga, please, you think I'm about to waste money again for you to potentially go halfway across the damn country where it's going to be even more expensive for you to fuck up? Simone, girl. So Contessa take her daddy to Heavenly to get his teeth fixed, and her daddy shows them the little gold grill that he bought at the mall or whatever. He think he fresh, he fly, he doing it. It was very sad, however, to see how much low self-esteem that he had. He couldn't even look at Heavenly in the face when he spoke to her. Like, he was like, yeah, hi, how you doing? It's good to meet you. Like, his head was down. He didn't look up. Like, you could just tell that his self-esteem was shot from all the years of drug use and his teeth being messed up. Heavenly did a really good job on his teeth. He looked so much better when they were done. So shout out to Heavenly and Contessa for doing that for her father, because hopefully it will help boost his self-esteem, because there's nothing more sad to see a grown man, especially a black man, not be able to hold his head up high and be able to introduce himself to a person and have that, you know, confidence and esteem about himself. So it's the day of Quad's party. And when her and her girls arrived, I was looking like, is this just the outfit that she got on right now just to come see the venue? I was like, okay, I'm not going to say nothing until later on. Okay, so I just kept it in my head like, this can't be the outfit. That can't be the her. That better not be the makeup. Oh, okay. So she gets there, and the decor, however, gorgeous. Beautiful, the floral centerpieces, that oval thing when she walked in, the spa station, the bar, the food, everything looked gorgeous. Only thing I kind of would have dealt with was them bitches with the angel wings and shit with the fairy lights. That kind of looked cheesy, but other than that, everything else was fucking fantastic. She had Storm from Ready to Love from On there as her DJ. It was good to see her back on the screen. Then we cut to Toya's house. We see Toya's two-story closet. They actually had a little thing on Bravo where she showed her closet, and it is beautifully done. That shoe display bitch is me all day. I'm a shoe girl, so her shoe display was gorgeous. I love the outlook, the layout and everything of just Toya's house, period. Her and Eugene really did a really good job with that house. It's beautiful. So Toya says to Eugene that she didn't even want to go to Quad's party because she didn't invite Mariah, and she doesn't want to look fake because she thinks that what Quad did was wrong and her and Mariah in a very good place. Where Toya and Mariah are in their friendship, I don't think that would be considered fake to go to Quad's party, because before last year, y'all weren't even fucking with each other like that. And at the end of the day, I'm grown. Just because I got a problem with somebody don't mean that you got to have a problem with somebody. Hopefully Mariah has that type of mentality and is not ignorant like that. But as you can see, Quad and Toya are about to have their own problems with Quad. They don't speak to her. As of right now today, Simone and Toya don't even fuck with Quad no more, and that's for their own issues with Quad. But I don't think that it was fake for her to go to the party to show support or whatever. And Eugene basically says the same thing to Toya. Mariah and her family, however, go to celebrate Ramadan. Mariah invited some of her girls there. Mama Lucy comes, her sister Lake, Dr. Jared, who was on a season of Married to Medicine. And I really felt like they didn't give Dr. Jared a chance. I really liked her aesthetic. I thought that she was beautiful. I want to see more of her. And as we can see on tonight's episode, she seems to have a problem too with Quad. Mariah brings up the drug situation. Now, at this point, let it the fuck go. You've proven, you know, your point. You've proven that you, you know, didn't do drugs or whatever the case may be. And I know it's a big thing for Mariah because it not only looks bad for her, but it looks bad for her husband because, you know, people are quick to assume that, oh, if she does do cocaine, that her husband probably does cocaine too because it's considered a party drug. And then that'll make an investigation go into her husband. So I understand why she's going so hard to an extent about proving that she did not do drugs. But at this point, when you pulled out the drug test and when you got it validated by Eugene, who was a doctor, who validated everything, that it was from a reputable company, that all the facts and everything, the stats and diagnoses were correct, at this point, wash your hands of it. I wouldn't even spend my time with my girlfriends even talking about that situation or talking about Quad. I wouldn't get that bitch no motherfucking airtime. Not from my mouth, not from me, bitch. Like, you, she should have pulled a Tammy. How Tammy did Evelyn the last two seasons, where she never even brought up fucking Evelyn's name. So every time Evelyn brought up her name, it made Evelyn look even fucking more childish and petty and obsessed with her. That's what she needs to do in Quad at this moment. Who? She needs to do a Mariah Carey, like Mariah Carey did J-Lo. I don't know that woman. Who are you talking about? That's what she needs to do. So at this point, Mariah, let the fuck go. Shut the fuck up. So Lake say, I think you've always been too nice to Quad. I mean, she's always been, you know what? Nate was like what you talking about? Nate was like a hoe. So I guess now Lake is, you know, fully confirming what Mariah said at the reunion about Quad, quote unquote, sleeping with her husband. And to be honest with you, I do believe that something happened because I think that was the reason why Quad then came back with these false allegations of drugs. So what can I say that a Trump would you said about me to keep that heat off of me? And as you can see, we've been talking about what Druggate. Ain't nobody talked about the fact that she allegedly slept with Mariah's sister's husband. Case closed, tied up in a bow. So Dr. Jerry said, it'll be interesting to see who goes to support her. And Mariah said, I'm not expecting them not to support her. I don't want them to pick a side. I just want them to pick the right side. And I see, Mariah, once again, this is where I got to call you out on your bullshit. Like, it ain't no right side, no wrong side, bitch. Whoever fuck with you, whoever don't. Like, fuck all that high school shit, girl. This ain't an episode of Mean Girls. This ain't Mean Girls 3. Sit the fuck down with that stupid shit. Like, let the viewers see what it is. Just like, once again, time back to Tammy and Evelyn. Everybody was going in on Tammy when Tammy accused Evelyn of lying about fighting Chad and this, this, and that. Everybody was villainizing Tammy, and then once Tammy set the fuck back and let the evidence come out on its own, and for Evelyn to be her own worst enemy and to show people that she really is a foul motherfucking person, that's all you gotta do. Let the chips fall where they may, ma'am. When you do wrong to people, that shit don't stay hidden for long. Whatever's in the dark shall come to the light. My mama's always told me that. Just sit the fuck back. God gonna always make your enemies your footstool at the end of the goddamn day. So if what you're saying about Quad is true, this shit gonna come out in the wash anyway. So all that right side, wrong side, that's neither here nor there at this point. So some girls say they already picked sides. And I was like, exactly. Half of the group has picked the side, and that is Quad's side. Let them do that. Fuck them hoes. They don't fuck with you. You don't fuck with them. Keep it the fuck moving. So when the party starts, I then realized that, oh, that's Quad's outfit for her party. I was like, was there no budget left for hair and makeup and outfit? Did you spend all your money on the event, ma'am? him. That wig was thin and a mess. Quad does not look right with blonde hair. She just, it just does not. It has nothing to do with her skin tone, because I'm a firm believer that chocolate girls can wear all different kind of colors of the rainbow. Quad, on the other hand, is just not one of those girls where blonde looks good on hair, on her. That blonde wig was a mess. Her makeup, I hate the way Quad does her makeup. She always wear them old ass Mary Kay lipstick colors, them sateen lipsticks and shit. Her makeup just look throwback as fuck. It don't look fresh. It don't look new. Like, bitch, wear a matte lip. Like, do something. Then, on top of that, she had on that lace doily short set suit. It was a mess. That was ugly as fuck. She blended in with all of her guests. She did not stand out. Like, if you gonna have a white party, if you gonna wear white yourself, bitch, you better have on the baddest white outfit in that damn room, first of all. And secondly, when she did change later on in the episode, she changed into this silver sequin jumpsuit, which was quite fetch. It was everything. I loved it. It fit her body perfectly. But the hair and the makeup just didn't set the outfit off right. So for fashion, no. So, the ladies arrive, everyone except for Contessa arrives at the same time. They all sitting down, they talking, and somehow the conversation of pussy smells come up. And Simone say that she got quite like a candle or something, so she gonna be smelling, I guess, the bedussy in the room or something when she fuck. And Heavenly say, did you take care of that smell? And Simone kind of look like, bitch, wait a minute, you trying to say my pussy stink? And so then they cut back to a previous episode from another season when Simone was saying she don't want to smell nothing down there on her lips. And I was like, so what did Simone basically say? She got a little stitch up pussy. I don't know. I didn't know what the fuck was going on. Jesus, it was too much for me to handle. Yeah, Simone, you a doctor, bitch. I don't understand that. Like, get that shit fixed. or if you just weirded out by that period, it ain't smell be damned. I don't know. It don't bother me. I mean, So, like I said, Quad goes to change, and she then takes the mic and she gives this speech. You know, she got to have her Maya Angelou, Toni Morrison moment, because she's so fucking extra. And she calls up Selena Johnson and her other co-hosts from Sister Circle and some other folks, and she starts giving this a speech to acknowledge them. And she say, I need to highlight the people that made a difference in my life, because at one point, I was about to give up on women, period. And so Simone and Tori looking like, oh, really, bitch? You was about to give up on women? AKA us? Oh, okay, bitch. So, Jackie and her confessional say, really quiet? And then Quiet say, I was about to give up on friends. The Sister Circle showed me that women can support other women. And Contessa say, ouch. Ooh. And so Simone say, we leave it. Like, because she ain't even had time for the fuck shit. So Simone, Toya, and Eugene then decide to leave. And then when they leave, Quad then acknowledges her castmates and say, you know, I do want to acknowledge my castmates on the show. And she asks where Simone and Toya went. And Contessa say, some people gave up on you, but we knew you were coming back around this way. Bitch, no the fuck you didn't, because you said, ouch. Now, Contessa, I was liking you your first two seasons. Now this season, you starting to get on my motherfucking nerves. Contest, you really is. I feel like you a go along to get along girl. I feel like you're trying to conform so you can be in a clique so these hoes can like you. Because season one and season two, for you wasn't really taking sides. You was like in the middle. And I see now, like, you're trying to be all buddy-buddy with Heavenly and Quad and shit and being, like, kind of low-key on some fake shit. And I ain't really digging it. So Quad and her confessional say, are the girls, are the people jealous? Because I didn't speak their name first. Well, let them be mad. Let them eat cake. And I'm like, girl, okay, Bob, the drag queen, sit your ass down somewhere. So Quad say, you all are amazing. You speak life into me. Now, I don't know what else she said, but it didn't seem like her speech was as passionate to them as it was to the Sister Circle folks. And at the end of the day, what she did was shady. It was shady as fuck to separate the two. Get the fuck out of here. That was some shady ass shit. She already made it known last season that she was closer to her Sister Circle girlfriends than she was her castmates. So, bye for nigga. She knew exactly what the fuck she was doing. And for you Quiet fans, this your girl. This your girl right there, girl. That's y'all girl. So then Quiet surprises herself with her own car. And Thomas, I didn't even know it was coming today. make sure to thumbs up this video, like and subscribe, hit that notification bell button. Let's talk down below. Let me know what y'all thought about tonight's episode. I give tonight's episode of Married to Medicine a B-. It was cool for what it was. The mid-season trailer aired. It looks like the second half of this season is going to be very dynamite. It's going to be very good. I'm looking forward to it. Let's talk down below in the comment section. And I will see you all tomorrow for Love and Hip Hop. Bye.